thousands of people gathered on the National Mall here in Washington, D.C. today to commemorate the iconic 1963 March on Washington and to create a new march of their own. Today's call for an end to killings of black Americans at the hands of police. Yamiche Alcindor reports.
We almost ran here when we saw the crowd. I'm very inspired.
Angela Flannery's late mother, Helen, witnessed in person Dr. Martin Luther King deliver these iconic words at the Lincoln Memorial. King's speech was the culmination of the historic March on Washington in 1963. It brought together more than 250,000 people to the nation's capital to demand economic and racial justice. 57 years later, in the middle of a pandemic, the 53-year-old drove her daughter Zora and their friend Rebecca Phoenix more than 500 miles from Detroit to D.C. She wanted to stand where her own mother had stood on that historic day.
Those stories became my stories. And I also want to model for my daughter that we have to stand up, and that this is a struggle that's going to be ongoing, that you have to participate in.
I spoke to the group as they toured Washington earlier this week. 15-year-old Zora said she needed to be here.
There's just so many people that are ignorant to the problems that are going on in this country. And I need to see that change in my lifetime.
Today on the National Mall, the group joined the Get Your Knee Off Our Necks rally. It was organized by Reverend Al Sharpton's civil rights group, the National Action Network.
Black lives matter, and we won't stop until it matters to everybody.
The march was planned in response to the police killings of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and other African Americans. The killings fueled protests around the country throughout the summer. But this week, video of a police officer shooting Jacob Blake 7 times in the back in Kenosha, Wisconsin, sparked new outrage. Blake survived, but his family says he's paralyzed from the waist down. They said he was handcuffed to his hospital bed until earlier today when he posted bond. He faces a number of charges, including a third-degree sexual assault charge from July. His attorney told NewsHour Blake plans to plead not guilty. His family spoke at the march.
We will not be your docile slave. We will not be a footstool to oppression.
Democratic vice presidential nominee Kamala Harris also made an appearance in a pre-recorded video.
If we work together to challenge every instinct our nation has to return to the status quo, and combine the wisdom of longtime warriors for justice with the creative energy of the young leaders today, we have an opportunity to make history right here and right now.
Organizers required all attendees to have tickets, wear masks, and get their temperatures checked. But despite the potential health risks, thousands came to stand in solidarity against police brutality. CJ Jessup came from Minneapolis. He says George Floyd was killed a block from his home.
I wanted to come here because I wanted to be a part of change. I wanted to be a part of one of the voices.
Linda Roebuck traveled from New York City.
I am so tired of crying in my bedroom, watching our brothers be killed by police. I'm so tired of it.
Organizers say they hope today's march spurs new legislation aimed at stopping police violence against African Americans. They point out that after the 1963 march, both the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act were both passed.
It's impossible to overemphasize the importance of that moment for everything that's happened since. This is a march that had to happen.
Earlier this week, I spoke to D.C.'s delegate to Congress, Eleanor Holmes Norton. Back in 1963, as part of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, she helped organize transportation for the March on Washington.
Just as in 63, the country says we're not going to take that anymore, there must be equal treatment, I think you're hearing that same refrain when it comes to police actions that take the lives of people needlessly.
We do not want our freedom gradually, but we want to be free now.
On that August day in 1963, the youngest speaker was the late Congressman John Lewis, who died last month.
Today we think of John Lewis as this iconic, monumental figure. At the March on Washington, he was the young radical.
Historian John Meacham wrote a biography of Lewis, published this week.
The worldview he brought to the racial and economic problems of injustice of his time, I think, is incredibly relevant to to where we are now. Not because it means everybody should wait, quite the opposite. It means freedom now.
And 57 years later, that message is still being echoed by young African Americans like Zora, the third generation in her family to come to Washington and fight for equality. She was thinking of her grandmother.
It says a lot that I need to come back here, but otherwise, I feel really proud, and I'm proud to be able to take on her fight, her struggle, and to hopefully end things in my generation so we don't have to do this again.
Just before the family spoke at the march, I had a chance to sit down with Jacob's father.
Tell me a little bit about how your son is doing. I've heard he's paralyzed, he's handcuffed possibly.
He's paralyzed from the waist down, and he needs support right now. He's not feeling well, he's not doing good. You know how your child tells you, I don't feel good, Daddy. That's what he told me. He said, Daddy, I just don't feel good. I said, well, Daddy's gonna be here. You know, I don't care how old your children get, they're still your babies. Still, I'll always be your baby. So when he squeezed my hand and he started weeping, I weep right with him. I weep right with him, but I love my son. He's a human being. He was shooting my son while he was pulling my son's shirt to get him closer to him. What sense does that make? How do you think a parent would feel watching his son basically attempted murder on your son by the people that are paid to protect and serve?
What was it like for you to watch that video knowing that that was your child?
When I first watched it, I got a little emotional. Then I got mad. Then I sat down and got determined. And then I realized I have to do what I have to do. I'll never leave my son's side because he said he never wants to go outside again.
What are your grandsons saying right now?
The day my son was shot was my eight-year-old grandson's birthday. So 2 hours before he was shot, he was on the phone telling his pop, that's me. Oh, he had a list of what he wanted, and he was so excited. I could hear his little feet. He was telling me what he was gonna get and what he wanted his daddy to do. And then 2 hours later, this. My father was here at the first march in D.C. He marched from Selma to Montgomery. He got whooped on the Edmund Pettus Bridge. So sometimes you get to whooping directly, and sometimes you get them other ways. We'd all planned to come here, and then this happened. So I said, well, I cannot not be here. I don't think we've come far at all, okay? This is 2020, and we're still fighting to vote? It's 2020.
What does it mean?
It means that chattel slavery was a powerful thing. It's never gone anywhere. They've taken the chains off only from around your ankles. Our brains are chained, our wallets are chained, and you can't even touch the chain. But that's how diabolical chattel slavery was to us as brown and black people.
Did you anticipate that this might happen to your son? And what did you tell him?
Being a black man, we anticipate that it might happen to us at any second of any day. When a policeman pulls me over, the first thing I think is they getting ready to shoot me. I'm too damn big. So I hurry up and pull my handicap sticker out. Hey, look, you'll have no problems for me.
What do you make of the protests, the NBA boycotting? What do you make of what?
I was on the phone yesterday with the entire bubble. That means every team that was in the bubble. And they asked me what I wanted them to do. And I said I couldn't tell them what to do. But the Milwaukee Bucks showed you the way. And the Bucks called me every night. And we were in tears. The whole Bucks team and myself cried on the phone together. So if you don't think it's real, it's real. And it starts, the athletes are setting precedent. So I'm not gonna stop.
And again, Yamiche spoke with Jacob Blake's father this afternoon just before his son was released from police custody. He's no longer handcuffed or restrained, but he does remain in the hospital.